Of Copenhagen, who will tell us how modal types can help with certain problems in functional reactive programming.
Thank you. So this is joint work with my supervisor Rasmus Møhlberg and our colleague Patrick Barr. And it's titled simply RAD, a Fitch-style modal calculus for reactive programming without space leaks. So first off, what is reactive programming? A reactive program is a program that has continual interaction with the environment. We think of it as reading input from the environment and producing output to the environment. This includes control software, servers, graphic user interfaces, and all kinds of things. Traditionally, this is done in an imperative fashion with a shared state and callbacks and big networks of these. And hence, they're very difficult to reason about, and they're error-prone. And that's really a problem nowadays, because many safety-critical systems are done in a reactive fashion. So we learned on Monday that, for instance, Ethereum is done in an imperative fashion. And if you know a bit about Ethereum, this is not really good, because there's a lot of money involved. So what do we do instead? Well, we want to do functional reactive programming. So why do we want to do that? Well, we want to be able to reason about our reactive programs. We want high abstraction with efficient implementations. We want modular programs, and importantly, we want safety guarantees. So here's an overview of what we have done for the initiated. So we present SimpliRAD. It's a new language for modal FRP. It's based on the Fitch-style approach to modal types. There's a type system that ensures safety, causality, and productivity. We have a heap-based operational semantics that rule out space leaks by construction. And the meta theory has been formalized in COG. So let me spend some time unrolling what this means. So first of all, what is really functional reactive programming? Well, functional reactive programming uses data types that represent values over time. And values that change over time are called signals. Programs now become stream transducers. We take a signal A and produce a signal B. One way to implement this is with signals as streams. So a stream is this data type where we say a stream unfolds as a head of type A and a tail of a stream. And in the functional reactive sense case, we really think of this unfolding as taking time somehow. You get the hit now, and you get the rest of the stream later somehow. When you do this, if you use signals this way, there's some known problems. And these are causality, productivity, and space leaks. So causality. We say that a program is causal if the nth output depend only on the first n inputs. So here's something that's not causal. So in this program, we read a stream, and we want to produce a stream. And we say, well, the output, the first element of the output should be the second element of the input. And we can't do that. Well, we can't do that in the reactive sense here, because if you really think of the programs as reading from the environment and producing in the environment, the stream function has to be causal to be implementable. Otherwise, we can't really implement them. A second useful thing to have is not strictly necessary, but it's nice to have, is this notion of productivity. So we say a program is productive if output is produced at every time step. And this really means, well, the useful programs, right? The programs we can expect to actually give us something. So here's something that's not productive. So this program is supposed to be a stream, and we say, well, just do the tail on the recursive call. This won't do anything, it'll just chug along forever. A bit more technical is this notion of a space leak. So one way to explain what a space leak is when we say a program has a space leak if the execution of the program uses more memory than expected, and the memory is released later than expected. And this is particularly important for reactive programs, because these usually are very long running, and they have no natural termination point. So if the memory is not released when we expect it, well, it might accumulate forever, and you get a real the program will crash. So as an example of this, we imagine we want to create a program here that takes two streams. It takes a stream of Booleans, and it takes a stream of natural numbers. And if the Boolean stream is false, you just give a zero back. And if the Boolean stream is true, you return the head of the natural number stream, right? So crucially here, it returns the head in both cases, right? So it really doesn't care about the tail. So one way to implement this is this slightly convoluted way. So what we really do is, well, we take the Boolean stream of the natural numbers. Then we recurse only on the Boolean. And what we say is, well, we do a let binding, and we say, OK, if the head is true, then return the head of the natural numbers. Otherwise, do zero, and then recurse on the Boolean. The problem is, unless you have a very, very eager evaluation strategy, the call to head here won't be done until and if you actually get true. So you will have to carry along the full natural number stream, right? So you have to keep accumulating the input here. So you have to keep buffering the natural number stream. And this might lead to a space leak. So can we fix it? Well, the problem here is that streams are not stable over time, right? That's the whole point. They change in the functional reactive setting. So you should not push them into the future. So what you can do here, you can really fix it by just do the call to head up front. You say, well, I only care about the head, so I just evaluate it up front, and then I only shove the one single natural number into the future. And this is fine, right? Because natural numbers don't change. So the idea is that, well, to avoid leaks, we should only push stable things into the future. The problem is they are very hard to differentiate in the naive approach. We don't really know what's stable and what is not. And worse, if we compose our programs, it's unclear if things keep being stable. OK, so there's some things you can do. One possible solution is that you simply restrict the API. Well, you tell your programmer you can't have access to signals because it's very dangerous. So you can only have some predefined combinators, and then you can build your programs doing that. And that can be very successful, right? The whole errorized FFP approach is based on you give some predefined combinators and you build things. So it's not bad necessarily. But we think it has some drawbacks. And in particular, you lose the simplicity and flexibility of the original formulations where you just have signals. So we really want to have first-class signals, right? We want to be able to work with them. So one approach that's done this is this modal FFP approach. So in modal FFP, you take FFP and you add some modal types. So usually you add this one modality you call later or delay, and then circle A really denotes A one time circle, right? Like A in the future. And we now work with guarded streams, right? So note here the unfolding now becomes guarded by the modality. And importantly here, the timing actually becomes explicit in the type. We can really see now that the unfolding takes time, because the time happens right in the tail. So this immediately gives us causality. If we look at the non-causal function from before, it simply doesn't type check anymore, because now we try to call head on a delayed stream, right? So the tail here is delayed, so we can't call head on it. It's not there yet, right? So we immediately get causality, and we actually also get productivity. Okay, so that's the framing, so what have we done? The goal of this work is that we really want to get a full dependent type theory for reactive programming. We really want to reason properly about reactive programs, and this is a step on the way. So SimpliRad is simply typed. And importantly, we use this fetch style approach. And we do this, well, for a couple of reasons. But importantly, it removes the need for let bindings. As we heard in the first talk, usually the way you do these modal type things is that you use let bindings, right? And if you want to go to a dependent setting, we don't really want let bindings. They can kind of model it up. Also, we think that it also allows for a simple and very concise way to program. We actually think it's pretty neat to use this system. And in particular, we have a heap-based operational semantics for streams and streams transducers. We disallow implicit space leak by construction, and this is following a result by Krishnaswamy for another language that's vaguely similar. And we have a type system that ensures safety, causality, and productivity. So let's look at what this language actually looks like. So this is on a slightly simplified syntax. So one thing, like the easiest things you can do in this streaming language is that, well, you can create the constant stream over some element. So to do that, well, we want to reuse this element again and again in each time step. So it has to be stable, right? So read this, given a stable type, given an element of the stable type, I can produce a stream that's just that type, that term, that value repeated again and again. So the way to read this function declaration is that the hash works kind of like the log we saw previously, that it separates the constant into stable and dynamic things. So whatever comes before the hash is stable, so we can actually push it into the future, right? So what do? Well, you just say, here's the first element, then you want to recurse, but you want to recurse in the future, right? So this delay construction really pushes something into the future. And now we can do the recursive call, and this is safe to do because we know A is stable. So it's actually okay to do this in the future. You could also create a zip function. It takes two streams and just produce the product of them. And here, there's nothing stable, right? We know streams are purely dynamic, so we should really treat them as being dynamic. So what do? Well, you can create the head immediately. You just pair up the head of the input streams. And now, again, I delay because I want to create a guarded stream. And I want to do a recursive call. But now, since I'm in the future, right, this happens in the next time step. It happens under the delay. And I know the tails of the two input streams were delayed when I got them. So now I can actually use them in the future. This is what the advanced construction does. It says, well, if you had something delayed and you move a time step forward, you are allowed to use it, right? So this call also works. And just to show we can actually do like proper dynamic things to the data flow graph, here's the switch function that takes a stream and an event over a stream, and then chucks along as the stream until the event happened, and then it continues as the other stream. Okay, so let's look at the type system. So traditionally, when you do modal FRP, you use a dual context system. So if we start looking at the variable rule here, you really split the context into two parts. You have a now context and a later context. Then you can only do variable introduction from the now context, because the later context really represents variables that will arrive later. Okay, so you have to only use the now variables. So what can you do if you actually have a term of a delayed type? Well, you can add a variable to your later context, and then you can use it to type something, right? And this is the lead binding approach I talked about here. And then suppose now we actually had a really dependent system and C were to depend on X. Well, then the type of C would again really have to be a lead binding. And we don't really want that in a dependent system, right? So this is why we want to get rid of the lead bindings. And finally, how do you create a delayed type? Well, you have your now and your later context. And to move into the future, you really throw away all your now variables and you use your later variables as now variables. So this is what we have done before. So what we do now instead is that we use a fit style approach. So as we heard in the first talk, in this fit style approach, we have a context and then we add a token to it. So in our case, we only have a single token. It's called a tick, or a single token so far, and it's called a tick. And it really represents a witness that time has passed. So tick here separates the context into time regions, right? So normally when you have a context without a tick, it's really just a now context. Then when you add a tick, you think time has passed, right? So everything before the tick, it happened earlier, and everything after the tick happens now. So to create a delayed type, something of a delayed type, well, you really have to only show that if time passes, you can type it. And similarly, if you have something of a delayed type, well, this means that if time passes, you can use it, right? So you can advance on it. So if you can show it's delayed and you have a witness time has passed, you can really use it. And the point here is now you have to respect the tick, right? You can introduce variables across the tick because this would mean pushing arbitrary things into the future. And we don't want that, right? So this is why we say you can't just push stuff into the future. So to push stuff into the future, it needs to be stable. So we have two notions of stability. One is just types that are inherently stable, right? Natural numbers, units, products, and some of these, and so forth. Like they never change, they don't do anything. But a separate way to create stable things is given some type A, we can restrict down to only the stable terms of that type. This is represented by a second modality, the box modality, which we heard about before. And the point is that box A is a stable type. And the way you do it, well, if you want to create something of a box type, we have this second token, because again, we do it in a fit style approach. And this is why the token showed up in the earlier example. So the hash here really means stability, right? It means that dynamic stuff can happen. So if you want to create a box type, you have to show in a context where dynamic stuff can happen, you can always use it. And again, if you have a box type and you're in a context where some dynamic stuff might happen, you are allowed to use it, right? So you can get it arbitrary in here. Okay, and finally, the way we actually get causality or productivity is by a slightly modified Nakano-styled fixed bind. I won't go through the typing of this. The important point here is just that this itself creates a box type. And the point is that fixed points in a reactive setting unfold in the future, right? So when we do an unfolding, we might go into the future. So to actually have a proper fixed point, it needs to be stable, right? And this is again because you can't push arbitrary data into the future, you can only push stable data into the future. So to get proper reactive recursive definitions, they have to be stable. So here's some example in the actual language. First of all, we can show that both circle and box are applicatives, and that's very nice, they're easy to program with. And here's an example of something you would like to do. So to create a map function, so mapping over streams, normally you would take a function and you just apply it. And here the point is that the function you get has to be stable, right? Because we want to apply it at each term in the stream. So we have to push it safely into the future. So you get an f and it's stable, so it's before the hash. Then you get your stream. Then you want to apply f to the stream. So you unbox it, right? You pull it into whatever time step you're in. And then you simply recurse with an applicative call to make the delay works out. And here's the full unfolding in the calculus, right? It's what you would expect if you know fixed points. Okay, so finally, how do we actually eliminate space leaks? And this is done via the operational semantics. And again, this is following a result by Krishnaswamy. So we define a heap-based big step operational semantics, right? And here sigma represents the stores that's comprised of heaps. So we say T goes to V in some store, and the store might change. And what the store is used for, it's used for allocation of delayed computation. So when we unfold fixed points, it's used for delayed computation, it's used for recursive calls, so when we unfold fixed point, and importantly, it's used for input data for stream transducers. So if we create a stream transducer, the input data is allocated on the store. And then we have this result, and I showed here for streams, and here it takes a little reading, right? So the point is here, this is the store, and the store has a very particular shape. It says that it means the same thing as the typing does. It really means you can do some dynamic things, then you have allocations you can read now, meaning things that were allocated previously, and then you allocate stuff in the future, like stuff that can be used in the next time step. Then if you have something of type stream, and you have some allocations from previous steps, well, you say, evaluate a stream. The stream should evaluate to some value now, and a label. And this label points into the heap. the future heap, right? So this is a label that points to the unfolding, like a delayed computation that will unfold in the next time step. So this points to whatever delayed computation you need to compute the tail of the stream in the next time step. And then we say this whole thing steps emitting V to advance on L, right? And advance because this is the delayed thing, and the next time step we should be able to use it. And the point here is everything that was given to us previously and whatever we create during evaluation is removed in when we step in time, right? So we simply delete everything that was previously used. So this is what we mean when you can't have space leaks, right? Because we simply just delete all the data. So you can only use the things that is available in the next time step. We have a similar thing for streams and stuza, and again, the input data is allocated on the heap for streams and stuzas, right? So we really garbage collect very aggressively. And we have an evaluation, we have a theorem saying evaluation of streams and transducers is safe. So just to get an idea of what happens, if we have a stream of natural numbers, then in general, the end unfolding will happen like this. You have the natural numbers, you have some store. This will evaluate to the natural number n and a label, and the label will point to the unfolding in the next time step. Then the unfolding will look like this, simplified. So you get the natural numbers in each time step, and the point here is that you keep deleting the heap. So you only retain whatever is needed for the unfolding in the current time step. Okay, so summary. We have created a new language for modal FRP, and we use this Fitch-style approach. And twofold, we remove the need for lead bindings, which is nice, and we think we actually get a pretty concise and simple language. We have a heap-based operation on semantics that rules out space leak. And I wrote previously, this is the implicit space leaks. The point is, if you really want to retain data, you can do it, right? But then you have to be very explicit about it. So the point is, as Andre said earlier, right, you can shoot yourself in the head if you want, but it should not be an accident. And we have a type system that ensures safety, causality, and productivity, and we actually have a way to rule out some time leaks in the language, and this showed up during a proof, and we figured out to do it. I haven't talked about it. If you're interested, look at the paper. It has to do with unfolding recursion on the tail, and this has been formalized in Coq. In the future, we would like to have many ticks and many heaps. This says that there's no reason we shouldn't be able to reason about many time steps at once. Then the guarantee would say something like you retain data for n plus one step if you have n ticks. We want a denotational semantics for it. We want a logic on top. And finally, we want to get dependent types, full rad. Thank you.
So questions. So first, a question from Slido. So does this mean circle is right adjoined to box?
Okay. There's a yes. So I quite like this idea that indeed with type you can handle passing time and you can make program safer because of typing constraint. A bit of advertisement on Friday morning. I will show how to do audio programming with control, with streaming processing in Haskell without space leak, and it goes fine and it's efficient. It goes very fast. My question is that with this model typing, can you indeed combine one stream of audio and one stream, say, of MIDI event that will control the audio processing you, the transformation you want to do on the audio? So having two streams, but one is very synchronous audio, the other one is when it comes, when you have new MIDI events.
I mean, I don't want to say if I can and can, because this is we don't have a lot of real-world implementation of this, right? I mean, one thing is here...
I would be perfectly happy with an implementation in Coq of that.
Sure. I mean, the short answer is I don't really know. We have programs that do real things running, right, or we can do small games and stuff, but... I don't know. That's the short answer, right? I mean...
Well, that's a fair answer, anyway. Thank you.
We can do the same thing Yamba can. If you can do it in Yamba, we probably can do it too.
Okay, so we have another question from the audience.
So you said that you can actually retain data if you want, if you really, really try. So you could technically construct something like, let's say, a deduplicating function that removes duplicates from your stream by pushing them into the future.
Yes, but only in a very specific way, right? So the point is, the way you could do it is streams are never stable, right? But assume if you had lists in the language, right? If you added the inductive type list, then you could, in each step, well, just accumulate whatever data you come in the list. Then the list itself is stable, right? That doesn't change. then you add more to the list and you push that into the future. So you can, right? But the point here is that it would show up immediately in both in the typing and in the program that that's what you're doing. So that's what I mean. There's no implicit leaks, right? You really know what you're doing if you're doing it. Okay. That's the dream anyway.
So maybe while the next speaker starts setting up, there's another question from Srido. So could you use two spaces, now and next, and never garbage collect anything that is not stable?
I don't know. Maybe. I don't know. Come ask me after if it's interesting.
Okay, so maybe a final question. Can you define the streams from basic type constructors and modalities? Some later fix points.
Sorry, I didn't get that.
So I think they mean, is it true that you can define any stream from these sort of three primitives? Some later and fix points. Or maybe someone can clarify.
Maybe, I don't know. Maybe, ask afterwards. Thank you.
Thank you. So.